All right. I love giving this introduction of my good friend, Dr. Bonomi, Luca Bonomi. Even though I know him very well, I want you to know a little bit more about him. So I am going to give the formal introduction. Luca Bonomi is the president of the Societa Dante Alighieri, a language school in Siena, Italy. This also happens to be the language school where BYU hosts where our BYU program is hosted by Dr. Bonomi and his staff. Dr. Bonomi makes annual trips to promote the school's cultural and linguistic activities abroad. I've learned this trip that he has taken over 10 trips to Japan in promoting the association's activities in Japan, as well as Korea, Norway, Sweden, Slovenia. So his work is that of not just an Italian nature, but of a global nature in bringing awareness of Italian cultural studies and linguistic studies across the world. Dr. Bonomi's focus is on the pre-Romantic, Romantic, and the Verista periods. He was unanimously selected president of the Dante Alighieri Society of Siena in 2001. He received a degree in music and theater from the University of Rome La Sapienza, and he received a PhD in teaching Italian language and culture to foreigners at the University of Perugia in 1993. I would like to point out that this lecture is sponsored by the Kennedy Center for International Studies, the Department of French and Italian, the Center for the Study of Europe, and the General Education Department here at Brigham Young University. I would also like to invite all of you to remain after the lecture so that you can meet Dr. Bonomi personally and you can enjoy a little bit of gelato with us. Thank you very much. Please help us to welcome Dr. Luca Bonomi.
Thank you very much, Aaron. It's a pleasure to be here as always. And while I do apologize for my English, but I'm not able to read giving a lecture, so I beg your pardon, and I know that you are forgiven. You will forgive my mistakes. And by the way, this is more than a family home evening than a lecture, because I feel like at home when I'm at BYU. So you can always stop me if you do not understand, and we will ask the department, the Italian section, the French and Italian department, to help me. Even because, and of course, if you have any question, if you have any kind of suggestions to give me during this hour and a half, just please stop me, and I will be very, very happy to try to answer all your questions. I choose this topic this year, the Bel Canto, because talking with the American students, not from BYU, but from other universities, I see that, I think that there is a little bit of confusion between this definition of Bel Canto. Especially in America, they are used to use bel canto, like beautiful singing, but generally speaking, applying to, I don't know, Pavarotti, as well as to Bocelli, and I do not really agree about this last name. Or other aspects of the lyric opera. But for us, bel canto means something very particular. So the agenda of this family home evening will be, I will introduce a little bit from a theoretical point of view what I think when we can use Bel Canto, what Bel Canto is, and especially, and this is the first one will be the boring part, maybe. The second one, that it will last longer, we will see together some examples of Bel Canto. Okay, you can read much more better than listening to me what I think is a proper definition of Bel Canto. Because a Bel Canto is a kind of technique that starts the definition, first of all, these two words, Bel Canto, starts beginning in the first two, the first years of the 19th century, but is something that must be applied especially to the past, to the other centuries, to the to the past centuries, because Bel Canto is a mixture of, is a combination of techniques and traditions and kind of and areas that was created for this particular kind of techniques. So we will see together which when we can apply this definition, when it's not the case to apply this definition. But before starting listening this, I would like to treat from a historical point of view a little bit what why at one point in Italy these kind of techniques were created and how was it was possible for them to adjust the natural voice to this kind of unnatural, because it's the what we call impostata, a kind of techniques.
I have a question.
Please.
What does it mean getting nodes is impossible if you were using this technique?
Sorry, can you? Okay, sorry, sorry. So why do I put the Leonardo here? Because you know that he was one of the most famous, not only the only one, but one of the most famous science, let me say, who started to study the human body, not only from a superficial description, but going deeper. How? With the autopsies. The study, and most of them were illegal, so this, and Leonardo is the most famous, they started to analyze the body from the of a human being from an internal perspective. They started to they started studying the aspects of the human life of in the human body. And of course, you can see here the description of the body, of a human body from an external point of view. But this was his studies about an internal description, a mechanic description of how a human body works. And I selected the parts who are most connected with our field. So the vocal. He was the first one to study the phonetic, the phonal system and how it works, how do we produce the voice and the techniques and the breath and all the human parts who are involved into the vocal system. So he started studying this, and of course he realized how sophisticated was this system in producing sounds, different kind of sounds. In these are they, of course, they were already singing. I don't mean that Leonardo started with Leonardo the music and the vocal music started, because it was, the Gregorian techniques that was natural, was an empiric system in a way that they established step by step. But the vocal system, these studies started to become more and more important also for the singing production. I wanted to spend some words about Giovanni Camillo Maffei da Solofra, that he write two letters and one letter on the singing, Naples 1561. And for sure, reading this letter, he knows very well the anatomical description of the vocal system. So he studied Leonardo. He had the same attitude to apply from, let me say, a scientific point of view, the instructions for the vocal system. So in the letter he writes about the singing, he describes exactly the different kind of sounds, the techniques that can be applied for this singing. Andrea Vasallo in De Humani Corporis, Fabrica, 1543, describes exactly what is necessary for speaking, for singing, the breathing, again, he knows exactly how it works from an inside point of view. And then Girolamo Mercuriale, De Arte Gymnastica, that was published in Venice in 1601, and page 132, you can see this picture, and these pictures is for the singers, because compressing different parts of the body, they can breathe in another way, and they can produce some sounds that from a natural point of view are not possible to reproduce. It's not a, I wanted to tell you also that still now, in the breathing gymnastic, of course, with other kind of compression, but the physiotherapists use exactly the same point. So, and we are in 2013. So you see that the knowledge of this part of the body, of the system, of the production of the sounds, is very well known. Not only, of course, to those who study this, but also step by step by the singers. And we will see that the most important part in this kind of passage of the tradition of singing is due by the teachers, because they had the knowledge and they could teach everybody these techniques. Unfortunately, I can say that then the medicine progress, the knowledge of the human body, you know, you can use a washing machine in an appropriate way, or if you put a cashmere pullover at 100 centigrade, so you will devastate the pullover, but the problem is not the washing machine, the problem is yours, because you do not use appropriately the washing machine. So, they also discovered that with the male castration in the puberty, these men, of course, trained in the singing, not because they were just castrato, they were good in singing. They had to train always. They were able to produce a particular kind of voice. We have to remember especially two castratos that are the most famous in the history of the castratos area, Francesco Bernardi, and they had always a nickname. They took a nickname, and his nickname was the Senesino, because he was born and he died in Siena. And still now, closer to Piazza Gramsci, you can see the building, the palace, that he made building because he became very, very rich. The problem is that on 1,000 poor young men who were suffered this kind of surgery operation, just 3, 10 maybe, in a total of 10, became famous and they became rich. And the sacrifice was very hard for them to face. And then the most famous castrato in the history of the opera, that was Farinelli. Il Senesino went to London. He sung a lot of operas written by Handel, and especially Julius Caesar. According to you, in which role did he sing in Julius Caesar? Do you know this? Pardon? No. No, this is what we think immediately. Julius Caesar himself, because sometimes they used the castratos for the feminine characters, but also for the heroes, because Julius Caesar didn't have my voice, your voice, Aaron's voice. He had to have a particular voice and a completely unnatural voice due to the operation. So when you think about the castrato, so you think about always about the female characters. No, in most of the operas, the hero was Nerone, Caesar, Nero, Caesar, or whoever was sung by the castrato himself, because they had a very particular voice. Please.
In modern reproductions of these operas, do they then drop the octave, or?
This is a very interesting question. What do? They try to have or a female singer with a very low notes, or a man, a male singer with a very high notes. But we are not able to reproduce the kind of these sounds, because there are the so-called sopranisti. Sometimes they become famous for a short while, and then they nobody knows anything about them. But it's very, very difficult. It's impossible, I would say, to reproduce this kind of sounds. We are lucky because we have an example recorded by the last castrato of the Sistina Chapel, 1902. And I would like to listen to with you this little piece. Is it the Ave Maria by Gounod? So you see, you can hear his name was Alessandro Mareschi. You can hear how strange his voice, this voice, is. He was also old when he recorded this record, and also the quality, of course, is we are in 1902. But is just an example on how the sound was, because the castratos were very, very important for the bel canto, because their extension from a vocal point of view was incredible. They could do the low notes and the highest notes without problems, of course, but with a lot of training and with the main problem of being a castrato. So it was not a very nice life for them. In 1994, waving one of my friends. And in 1994, they made a movie about Farinelli. And in order to obtain like a kind of a voice similar to a castrato, they had to mix it with a computer female voices and male voices. We can see a very short part of this movie. First of all, for celebrating Farinelli, who is a very, very famous, and then also for see the reaction of the people, of the audience, when he sings. And this is not, was absolutely truth. So we had the report, we can read the reports on his concerts, and they describe exactly this kind of reaction from the audience. Were the reactions. Even because, think, they didn't have a radio, computer, it was the only time in the life of someone to listen, to be able to listen to him singing. So they were crazy. They went mad for this kind of concert. The orchestra conductor you see here is an Italian actor, but he plays the role of Farinelli's brother, Riccardo Broschi, and we will listen other arias composed by him. He was not really a great composer, even because with this guy he could compose everything, but with Farinelli singing these arias, everything would have been a masterpiece. There was also for the castratos like a kind of, they were like holy characters, because they sacrificed the sexuality for singing. Of course, the problem was that they didn't know, because they were not able to decide, usually the parents, because they were around 10 years old, so the parents decided for them. But for the people, they were a particular person who they were considered like someone who devotes a big part of the human being life for the music. Coming back to our short view of the Bel Canto field, I told you that the teachers had the main role in training the voices, in understanding the kind of voice. If a young kid had a beautiful voice, they suggested the parents to make him a castrato. But especially they were able to transmit each other these kind of techniques. And this is not only in the past, but even right now, the importance of an instructor, a vocal instructor, for someone who wants to become a good singer is incredible, is very, very important, because the tradition goes, we can understand how late the tradition of these techniques are for a singer. I can give you an example. This is not a Bel Canto example, but it's a very famous singer, Franco Corelli. So we will listen to him singing a very famous aria. And then I will show you how much earlier we can date the genealogy, I could say, of the teachers. Okay. Now, but you can do with other singer. So Franco Corelli, he was born in 1921 and he died in 2003. One of his teachers was Giuseppe Laurivolpi, who was a very, very famous tenor, 1892-1979. Then we miss someone. Sorry. I can do. Laurivolpi's teacher was Antonio Cotogni, 1831-1918. Antonio Cotogni's teacher was Antonio Tamburini. Antonio Tamburini's teacher was Bonifazio Assioli. Bonifazio Assioli's teacher was Angelo Morigi's, and Angelo Morigi started singing with Giuseppe Tartini. And the last one was this man from Hungary that was born in 1684. I can't pronounce his name, I'm sorry. I would made like a war between Italy and Hungary if I would try. And so it's 1684-1742. So what does it mean? That the Hungar Bohuslav, if I'm not wrong, through these people, transmitted to Franco Corelli the techniques of the singing. And you know, this is important that you take note of this, because usually we speak about schools in the art history or in the literature, etc. But not in the singing. In the singing, the most important part are the teachers you study with, because it's an heritage, and it's most of them, it's an oral transmission. It's nothing in written. Of course, there are manuals, books about the techniques, but most of them transmit orally these techniques to someone to another, from someone to another one. So it's fascinating if you think that it took me maybe 10 minutes for rebuild the genealogy from a singing point of view of Franco Corelli, but we can date his first teacher around the middle of 18th century. And we could also go later and earlier. So this is a very fascinating issue for me.
Talking about singing, we have most of the. I can show you about teachers. I can show you this.
This is Carlo Bergonzi, another very, very famous singer.
Questo è il fiato, questo è il fiato, l'arco. Questo è sul fiato, l'arco. Oh, questo è sul fiato, l'arco. Oh, questo è sul fiato, l'arco. So you see with this example that the the approach, the teaching method, is physical because they have to reproduce. They have to give an example to someone who is studying for, with them about this kind of techniques. So this, the teachers, when you listen to a new singer, try to understand with whom he or she learned singing, because there are different schools and different techniques. So after this short digression, I would like to come back to the bel canto. The bel canto means, and the most important era of the bel canto is middle of 18th, middle of 17th century, middle of 18th century. The bel canto is this particular kind of techniques that they applied without the control of the author of the music. So I mean, they received a piece, an aria that they had to sing. The first part was written, the music, by the author. The other part was created by the singer himself. And this means that most of the variation, that with the changes that we they were used to do, it's very, very hard to study this, because they were used to, the teacher was used to write down a little bit the notes that the singer had to sing, but it was not very detailed. So there are now singers who try to understand how it was possible to sing in which kind of a variation they were used to do. And one of the most famous is, of course, Cecilia Bartoli. Cecilia Bartoli, for her kind of voice, allows her to do, to sing more or less like a castrato. And her agility, she had as a teacher at the beginning, her mother and her father, who were both opera singers. And for this reason, she started very, very young using this agility in singing. So we will listen two or three arias by her. I didn't want to bring you words or whatever. You have just to enjoy and to understand how she is able to reproduce notes and sounds, and most of them come from the study she made studying the tradition of the castrato. One of her CD is called Sacrificium, just because are all arias from the castrato repertoire. Thank you.
Thank you.
So it's she is incredible. I will show you other two arias sung by her. But from a musical point of view, this was part of an opera, so part of a plot. And for 7 minutes, we do not go on with the action on scene, because we are incredibly shocked by her technique, but from a plot point of view, it's a little bit too much, because she repeats always the same word and the same concept. We will have to think about it, because the exaggeration of this technique was going to die the opera, to kill the opera, because it was just the vocal aspect important for the audience, but not the music and the plot, okay? So now we will see, because you can say, well, she was, she knew, she was recorded, so she acted, she sung like this because she knew. Now, a friend of mine, but it's possible also to see on YouTube, gave me this illegal, so she doesn't know it's a live concert, and she doesn't know that someone is recording. You will see also the poor quality of the image, but she is the same aria. See, listen how she sings. It seems like she is surprised by herself.
Thank you.
So you see that this is absolutely ad libitum. So she decides what she wants to sing, the notes, the variation, the changes she wants to do. And if you, I made this experiment with some of my students, put together this kind of music, this kind of singing, with these the Baroque masterpieces, like Bernini or Borromini. You see, watching the image and listening to the music, that we are in the Baroque era. So we want to impress. The goal was to conquer the attention, to shock someone who is in front of the Fontana di Piazza Navona, or listening to them. But again, the musician at that time had problems with them, with this kind of technique, because it was too much. And the a composer didn't have any power to stop these kind of changes, considering what they were singing, the words they were singing, and the plot. One of the first who started, and he was very good because he was just Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, so the power he had was a lot. He started to limit the singers. He started to say, no way, you have to sing the notes I want, because I know what you are singing, the words you are singing, at which moment of the plot, so I must decide. You are not allowed to overwhelm the audience with your changes. And one of the maximum example of this theory of Mozart is for sure the Queen of the Night by the Zuber flute, the magic flute. So we will see it with a singer that is Anna Favoni, that is very, very good in singing this role. You know what the Queen is, you know the aria, but you know what she is saying to her daughter. Yes, so it's she is cruel, and the acuti are coming into the brain of her daughter. You will have the English subtitle, because usually, especially the young people, are used to listen to this aria, and it seems like something nice that she is, because it's in German, she is saying something nice. No way. She is really cruel.
Töten und den mächtigen Sonnenkreis mir überliefern, aber liebste Mutter,
So you see that for what she's singing and the messages she wants to give her daughter, the notes are absolutely appropriate because she wanted to conquer her brain. She wanted to devastate her, the daughter's possibility to refuse to kill Zoroastro. And it's the fight between the night and the sun. The night and the sun that means the brain, with the also the Freemason vision of the life, and the night that is the face of the day where you can't see what is going on, that your eyes are blind, you are absolutely out of control. So in this case, the technique, it's very, very important, and it's not possible for any singer to sing higher notes. So you can understand how difficult it is to sing this aria, but is logical. From a plot point of view, from a meaning, the message that Mozart wants to give us. The other one who took control, even because at that point the castratos were not anymore on fashion, let me say. They started to use the women, and they discovered the woman voice. They discovered how beautiful and the possibility to work with the women, and not only the castrato. So, step by step, they left the castratos just in the church, and especially in the Catholic church, in the Sistina Chapel, and they were absorbed by, fascinated the composers by the women, by the woman voice. And another one who took control, full control, of the changes, of the variation of the singers, was Gioachino Rossini. We will see, so we are 10 years later than the Magic Flute, and we will see a scene from Cenerentola, the last Cinderella, the last scene with Cecilia Bartoli on stage. And you will need to read the words, because the words, music, and technique become all together very, very important. Non più mai sta tanto il fuoco sta.
So you see that also in this case, what she sings and the way she sings is important for the plot, for the character of Cinderella that is going to marry the charming prince. But Rossini had full control of the situation. He decided the notes. And of course, if this is true for Rossini and then for Donizetti and Bellini, for Verdi, he didn't allow anything he didn't like. He didn't allow the singers to variate one note. They did, but they had to ask for for being allowed by the maestro, because he wanted to have full control of his masterpieces, also from a singing point of view, not only from the musical point of view. So I'm going to end with this message, especially for you young students. When you are in front of this kind of a big page of the history of the civilization, ask always, wonder always why. Because I was able to transmit to you that the medical, the science, the gymnastic, the tradition of the teachers, the rules of the castratos, a changing in the society. The society, the new society, the bourgeois society didn't need the castrato anymore, because usually when they were walking in the street, they didn't meet a castrato very often, and they didn't have any hero anymore. So you see that this kind of trend in the opera and in any art of a human being, it has a different different aspects, and it changes according to the new taste of the society, to the new rules of the society, to the needs of the society. We are talking with Verdi, with the class I'm teaching. I'm very proud and honored to teach her. To teach during these days, we are talking about Verdi. Verdi depended on the audience, because there were not a king or a grand duke involved. Audience paid for the entrance ticket, and he had in front of him the audience, the needs and the wishes of the audience. In the past, there were other needs, because the prince was paying for this. So when you are in front of something like the Bel Canto, try to go a little bit deeper, wondering you why this happened.